Well, good morning, Cathedral. How are you today? All right. You should be fired up. You mean, we're here in baptism. We're singing to the Lord. We're together in his house worshiping him. I'm really excited about our opportunity to be together. Go ahead and grab your Bibles. Turn over to anybody? Yeah, there we go. It does feel a little bit like we've been in Colossians for 6 years. We are on, Lord willing, the second to last message in Colossians. Next week we will be finishing that up. Pastor Ed is preaching at Deerfield Road today, and so you can pray for him even right now. And I will be there next week. He'll be back here opening God's Word next week as we finish up our series in Colossians. This passage is in chapter 4, beginning in verse 2, and we'll be looking at this in just a moment. Paul has gone through, in the book of Colossians, a little bit of a refresher for you. He's gone through some of the deep truths of the gospel. All through chapter 2, he's deeply explaining the truths of the gospel so that we really get it, that you grasp the reality of what Jesus Christ has done for us and in us and through us. And then he moves on into chapter 3 where he's telling us how we're to live because of the gospel. You remember all of the things that we're supposed to put off, all of the things that we're supposed to put on. We're told how to live holy lives in the light of this gospel that has transformed our character, that has transformed our identity in Jesus Christ. So we're to live some certain ways. And then last week we talked about, or sorry, 2 weeks ago, we talked about some of these relationships, the ways that we're to interact with one another as believers in the roles that we have in a way that honors the Lord and fulfills even the gospel in our relationships. And then today, Paul is moving then not so much to us, looking at ourselves, how has the Lord changed us, but he's looking at those who don't know, who don't yet know Jesus Christ. That our focus then turns from the internal to the external. Paul is concerned about this. The title of our message is Wisdom as You Witness. I'm grateful for the ways that the Lord has been encouraging and challenging our church in a lot of different ways to get outside of our walls, to share the gospel with the people that we come in contact with each and every week. And he's going to challenge us with that again today, trusting him for that. Now, witness is to share personal knowledge about the gospel of Jesus Christ with another person. Personal knowledge. So this isn't just an academic exercise, let me tell you the spiritual laws, let me walk through, it's not an academic thing, it's I want to tell you how Jesus has changed me, how the gospel has transformed my identity. Sebastian was in the tank today telling us how he became a new creation. He came forward, he prayed to receive Jesus Christ, and God changed him in that instant. And whether, no matter what age you are, if you're a child or you're much older than a child, God redeems each one of us and has that same story that I was dead in my sins and yet Jesus Christ made me alive. And we each are given that message, that gospel to carry to the world that so desperately needs it. All of us who have turned from our sins, who have trusted Jesus Christ by faith, who have embraced him and are walking in us, in him, each one of us desire that for others. When you've really grasped the gospel of Jesus Christ, you recognize what you've been saved from, and it drives you to love others in a way that communicate that same gospel to them so that they could turn from their sins and trust Jesus Christ by faith. They need to take hold of the gift. This isn't something we can force. They need to take hold of that gift on their own. Many don't, but we are given the message to faithfully and clearly communicate God's word, the gospel, to all of those who need Jesus Christ. And in this passage, Paul is telling us how, he's giving us a bit of a framework on how we're to go about this idea of wisdom as we witness. And if you want to see revival in the lives of the people who you come in contact with, if you want to see revival in the family members' lives who don't yet know Jesus Christ, if you want to see revival in your workplace, if you want to see revival in our church, in our city, in our nation, in our world, it starts by each one of us taking seriously the responsibility to communicate God's word to people that desperately need Jesus Christ. And Paul begins here in this passage with prayer. That's where he focuses. And so that's where we're going to start. Let's pray right now. Father, we are grateful for your incredible message of salvation. God, we recognize that while we were still sinners, Jesus Christ died for us. We recognize that we were that prodigal son running away from you, but you are the loving Father with your arms open wide, chasing us down the path and receiving us into your kingdom. God, give us a greater heart, a greater desire, a greater love for the lost, that you would use us to carry your perfect message to a world that desperately needs Jesus Christ. We pray this in his name. Amen. Colossians 4, beginning in verse 2, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us, that God may open to us a door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. And 2 weeks ago, as we said, we talked about these roles. Here he's moving on to how we're to carry out this message in relationship. And if you think back through all of the relationships that we listed and many others, if you're in a relationship with an individual, a friendship, a coworker, a spouse, you wouldn't imagine that relationship to continue without there being some ongoing communication. Right? Guys, in relationships, you figure this out, right? You got to talk to her. It's important, okay? That is for free. But you can't have an ongoing relationship, a meaningful relationship cannot happen without ongoing, continual communication. And so that's why Paul tells us to continue steadfastly in prayer. We need to be in constant communion with our Heavenly Father. If we're to serve him as we're called to, if we're to live as we are called to, if we are to share the gospel as we are called to, we need to be continuing steadfastly in prayer. It means to persist in something, to sort of busy myself with this. This is what I'm all about. I'm continuing steadfastly every day. This is what I'm doing. And I'm doing that in prayer, the total devotion of all of this. And he says that we're to do this by being watchful. It's a constant readiness and alertness. As I'm taking these prayer requests to the Lord, I'm scanning the horizon of my life to see how he's going to answer these. It's expectancy. I know that God is going to answer these things. I haven't figured out quite how he's going to do it, but I'm watchful. And notice it's watchful with thanksgiving. I'm looking for an opportunity to praise and thank my Heavenly Father for the ways that he has answered my prayer. I can tell you, I have prayed some crazy specific prayers in the last month. I mean, just like crazy things that I'm watching. Lord, how are you going to answer that? Lord, is this it? Is that it? I'm watchful with thanksgiving. And that's how all of us are to be doing this. We're to be watching for how is God going to answer this. We're to pray with expectancy. Martin Luther, famously, he had a friend and a ministry assistant. The guy's name was Myconius. Easy to say, I'm sure. But this guy, he gets sick, and so much so that the doctors are like, he only has a couple days to live. He's not going to survive at all. So Martin Luther writes this letter to his friend and sends it to them. By the time the letter gets there, his friend has lost all ability to speak. They're like, maybe today is his last day. And part of Luther's letter to him says, this is just crazy that he would pray this, but he says, I command thee in the name of God to live, because I still have need of thee in the work of reforming the church. Now, I've sent a lot of texts to some friends when they're sick. I've never said, I command thee to, but that's what he says. I command thee to live. The Lord will never let me hear that thou art dead, but will permit thee to survive me. For this I am praying. This is my will, and may my will be done, because I seek only to glorify the name of God. That is a bold and expectant prayer. And it would be a little bit crazy, except for within days of receiving the letter, Myconius fully recovered, no symptoms lasting at all. He went on to help Luther continue to reform the church. He ended up dying 6 years after this letter was written, 2 months after Luther himself died. I mean, like, dude is praying. I mean, now given, he's not praying for stupid stuff like a Ferrari. You know, he's praying that the work of the Lord would continue. And he's praying bold, faith-filled, expectant prayers. Crazy prayers. And God answers those things. He tells us to call to him, and he will answer. Here's a couple principles for intentional prayer. Pray expectantly. Believe that God will answer your prayer. It may not look exactly like you think. Joseph prayed. He had all these visions, and he's praying that these things would come to pass with all of his family members bowing down. Well, that happened. It happened in a very different way. But it happened. God answered that. So pray expectant that God would answer. He's a good father who tells us that he longs to give good gifts to his children. God wants to answer your prayers. And so be watchful. Be on the lookout for how God's going to answer. Pray expectantly. Pray specifically. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call to me and I will answer you and show you great and marvelous things that you have not known. God says, call to me. It's not this sort of sheepish, well, Lord, if you're maybe not too busy today, I would hope that maybe, I mean, it's not a big deal, but maybe you, it call out, it's cry out, yell to me. This is what God tells us to do, to cry out to him. Pray specifically, God, I'm asking you for my friend to live through this. I need him as we continue in this work for the gospel. God, answer this prayer, and God does. Pray specifically. Pray persistently. Remember the persistent widow that Jesus tells the parable of, continuing to ask. Well, I prayed really specifically one time, and God didn't answer it by the time the sun went down. Continue to pray. Oftentimes, the continuing to pray is the labor that makes my heart ready to receive what God is already willing to give me. And it's that labor that we need to continue in, we need to persist in, and then lastly, pray thankfully. Thank God for his faithfulness, for the ways that he has answered your prayers, for the things that he says no to. He says that because he loves you. Like my kids who ask for donuts every single morning, I'm not always going to give it to them because it's not healthy for them to eat donuts. Now I do sometimes, and sometimes I give them other things, but I'm trying to be a good father who gives good gifts to my kids. That's our Heavenly Father. So pray thankfully for his faithfulness. I want to give you a couple little practical tips that I've learned. These aren't gospel. These aren't found in God's word, but I've found them pretty helpful. Have a plan for your prayers. Have a plan. I have a note on the notes app on my phone of a prayer list. It's often that you're talking with somebody and they ask you to pray about something, and I write it down in there. Because I'm terribly forgetful, and I want to remember these things. So have a plan for how you're going to do that, a list in front of you for that. Carve out specific time. If you got to set your alarm at night so you actually go to bed on time so you can get up early and spend a couple minutes in prayer, however that is. If you ride the train and you want to spend a couple minutes looking at that list and praying on the train, whatever it is, but have a plan so that you can actually spend time praying, because we're the worst at this. We say, like, oh, yeah, I'll pray for you, I'm praying for you, when really what we mean is I'm generally having good thoughts about you. Like, how, just no show of hands, we've all done this, I think, but how often have you been like, yeah, I'm praying for you, when really you can't think of the last time you got on your knees and said that person's name out loud to the Lord? We should be convicted by that. We should pray specifically and have a plan to do so. So set aside, if you don't set aside the time and make it, block that out in your calendar, it's not going to happen. So have the time to do that. Make a plan, and then have a list, as I already said. Have a list in your phone or on a journal or whatever. I have, I meant to bring it, it's actually in my office. I have a little journal that I keep that I write down prayer requests, and I write down answered prayers. And this has been huge for me to remember God's faithfulness, because what happens is you might be in a mountaintop season right now, but in a month or two, you're going to start feeling like, where is the Lord? I'm not seeing answers. it's so helpful to flip back a couple pages. Great is your faithfulness, Lord. Look at the ways that you answered these prayers. So keep a record of those things. Have a list in that regard. Use a guide. This has been very helpful for me to have a specific like prayer guide. There's a lot of different books and things like that. These are two that I use quite often. This is called the Valley of Vision. There's Puritan prayers that were written, you know, who knows how long ago. But they're all really, really short. But this is very helpful for me to kind of frame my prayers to the Lord. I just follow through that. The other one, Pastor Greg Bradshaw mentioned this to many of us, and I've been using this a little bit, and I found this so helpful. It's called A Diary of Private Prayer. It's by John Bailey. And what he does is he has, like, you can tell I haven't been using it very long, but, like, on one side there's a written prayer, much like the Valley of Vision, and then on the other side there's just a blank page, and I'm specifically writing prayer requests. So this goes through, there's a morning and evening every day of a written prayer. These are things that you can use. I've found them very helpful. So Valley of Vision, Diary of Private Prayer, both of those have been helpful to me. Sometimes when you don't know what to pray, this sort of gets you started. So have a guide along our way. And then lastly, I would say get alone and pray out loud. Get alone, pray out loud. I've been talking here for just a couple of minutes, and I would venture to guarantee that every person in this room, your mind has wandered at some point. And maybe that's my fault. Maybe that's yours. I don't know. But the reason mine hasn't wandered is because my mouth is moving, because I'm talking. And I don't know how many of you have thought about this, where you're spending time praying, and you're praying about something specific. And maybe I'm praying about Elvin, and I'm thinking, you know, Lord, I just pray that you bless Elvin today. I pray that you'd use him as a small group leader and you really minister to him. And then I start thinking, like, man, Elvin and I play golf a lot, but it's been a little while since we played golf. We should figure out a time. And then, oh, yeah, I need to get a new hybrid club this year. Maybe I'll go to the store on Tuesday, and I'm, like, all the way over here thinking about golf clubs and when I'm going to go there when I was supposed to be over there praying for Elvin. Maybe it's just me, but when my mouth is moving, when I'm saying these things out loud, when I'm praying out loud, I'm able to stay on track and continue steadfastly in prayer. So having a guide and getting alone and having prayer out loud is super helpful as we grow in this. There's a lot of great ways that we can do this together. We have prayer meetings on Wednesday and Sunday morning that you can be a part of those times. So if you feel like, I need to grow in this, I want to work that muscle a little bit, come to some of those. We're doing this Hands Across Chicago thing on the 25th, May 25th. It's a Saturday. We're meeting to all pray. It's the most violent weekend in our city. The most shootings, all of that happens on that weekend. It's Labor Day weekend. And so we're getting together with Christians all across Chicagoland and praying for our city. These are great things to be involved in, to sort of like grow that prayer muscle. And Paul here says, he doesn't just say we should just pray in general. He actually says, verse 3, at the same time, pray also for us that God may open a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ. He's saying, open a door to us. Now, time out for a second. Does anyone else find this statement funny? Open a door. Maybe it's just me. It's not the cheesy, like, when God closes a door, he opens a window. Nothing like that. But, like, think about, where is Paul writing the book of Colossians? He's sitting in prison. I would assume there's a closed door in front of him. But he's actually, like, saying, so God, open a door physically. I got to get out of this prison. But also open a door in meaning, like, give me the opportunity. I love a good dad joke. And this is, like, right up my alley. I just, like, just cracking up. I heard about this one this week where there was a dad and mom who were on their way to the hospital, and they didn't get to the hospital in time, so the baby is born in the back seat of the car, and the dad named him Carson. I mean, come on. That's like, all day, that's my brand of humor. I would apologize, but I'm not really sorry. So, but that's what Paul is doing here. It feels like a dad joke to me. You know, like, open this door for us, Lord. We want more opportunities to share the gospel. But I don't think he's just being funny. He actually wants to get more opportunities to share the gospel. It's remarkable to me, though, that he doesn't say, like, man, I just want out of this prison. He's not even just doesn't even seem to care about that. He wants out so that he can go do more work. Now, he's in prison because he shared the gospel. And he wants to get out so he can go share the gospel some more, probably get thrown in prison again. But this is what his desire is. It's not just to get out, but it's to, he says, to declare the mystery of Christ. Listen, it is a mystery that Jesus Christ would leave heaven and dwell among us. That he would live a perfect life among us. That he would love the people who just showed up because they wanted some fish and loaves on the side of a countryside there. It's a mystery that Jesus Christ would die a brutal death for you and for me. It's a mystery that he would be raised from the dead to prove that he's God and to provide for our salvation. And it's a mystery that he would call a wretched sinner like me to him. That he would do all of that because he loves us. He would do all of that to bring us in a right relationship with Jesus Christ. This is the mystery that Paul is talking about. He chooses to use us. I think it's a mystery even, and I think Paul has in mind, that not just that he's saved us, but it's a mystery that he would use us wretched sinners to carry the most perfect message of all time. The most precious truth of Jesus Christ on the cross for the salvation of the world. He uses me for that. Talk about not feeling up to the task, but he uses us because this is a mystery, and he calls us to pray for these things. And as we pray for God to grant us the wisdom to communicate it clearly. That's the second thing as we're thinking about wisdom as we witness. Communicate clearly. He says, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. It means to just make it known, to disclose it, to get everything out of the way so that it can be seen perfectly. This is our job. The Holy Spirit's job is to draw men and women to himself, is to convict them of sin, is to save them. Our job isn't to save them, but our job is to communicate clearly the gospel. 1 Corinthians 1:17 says, for Christ did not send me just to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. We talk about this a lot when we talk about preaching and we talk about evangelism. Three words that are very helpful to remember. First, simplicity. Keep it simple. I think far too often we get, especially those of us who've been believers for a long time, those of us who have a lot of Bible knowledge, maybe some of you who have been to Bible college or whatever, sometimes we get in our own heads too much, and we try to make it too flowery and too, well, it's actually the imputed righteousness. Listen. Oh, okay, this is all true, and it's helpful, and we need to study those things. But when you're actually talking with somebody, make it simple. You're a sinner. You need a Savior. His name is Jesus. He died on the cross for your sins. Be simple in your communication. And then clarity. Simplicity, clarity. Just be real clear. You start getting into this like ethereal mysticism kind of thing. People are like, what are you smoking? I don't know what you're talking about. Just really clear. Simple, clear. And then the last one we talk about is urgency. Listen, people all around us are going to hell apart from Jesus Christ. And we are given the mandate and the opportunity to carry the gospel. But we need to do that with urgency. I don't know if this is their last day on this earth. I don't know. This person I'm talking to at work, I don't know. This might be the last time I ever get the chance to talk to them again. Urgency in that. Urgency. I want to share with you a really clear, hopefully, way that you can share the gospel. We call these the five gospel words. We'll run through these really quick. You've probably heard these before, but I want to give you a clear and simple way to share the gospel. We can just throw all five of those up there all at once. So this is a way that our pastors have developed. We got together for a retreat, and we're like, what is a simple and clear way to talk about the gospel? If you leave one of these things out, you don't have the gospel. In our world, I think there's a lot of things that people add to it. Oh, you also, you know, women can't wear pants and stuff like that, like stupid things like that that aren't in the Bible and aren't part of the gospel. But we wanted to get right down to it. What is the gospel? What do we need? So we narrowed it down to these five gospel words, God. Every communication of the gospel needs to start with God. There is a creator. He loves us and calls us into a relationship with him. Sin. But sin entered the world, first through Adam and Eve, and then through my conscious decisions. If you want to get into it with people, have you ever told a lie? Have you ever, you told a lie if you say no. You know, so you get right down to it. My choices of sin, but also my sin nature. So there is a God who calls us into relationship with him. We have sinned and broken that relationship. There is a gap between us and our Heavenly Father, and we're not able to get across that gap on our own. Three, substitution. Jesus died in my place. The big word is substitutionary atonement, but what it means is Christ on the cross for me. I should have been there, but he was instead. Corinthians tells us in 5:21 that he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. I took on his righteousness. He took on my sin. A substitution happened there. So God, sin, substitution. Number four is believe. Each of us need to come to the place where we believe in Jesus. We say it a lot of times here, turn from your sins and embrace Jesus Christ by faith. But Scripture, the word that it uses over and over is believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Making the decision, you have to take the step to believe in Jesus Christ to receive eternal life. And then that would be five. Five is life. Both eternal life, if you trust in Jesus, if you believe in Jesus, you will be with him in heaven forever. He grants us eternal life, but then also he gives us abundant life. I have come and to give you life and life abundantly, that God gives peace and grace. It doesn't mean your life is going to be perfect, but it means there's a perfect one walking with you through your life. And these five gospel words, the reason we share this is we just want it to be clear and simple and a helpful tool for you to be able to talk with people. There's lots and lots of other ways. Be happy to talk afterwards, or you can Google some specific ways to share your faith. But whatever the way, we need to be clear in our communication of God's word. Now, sometimes we can get the clarity of God's word down, but we're a jerk about it. And I think what it's actually saying here, what Paul is saying is, you know, he says that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. He's saying there is a specific way in which, not just the message, but there's a way in which I should communicate to people. And I think far too often we get in the, I got to get through my five gospel words, or you got to hear this, or you're going to hell tomorrow, and you got to, you know, and we start screaming at people when we forget about the fact that the message that we carry is a message of love and grace and forgiveness. And my tone and your tone in communicating that should reflect the message of love and forgiveness. Now, I'm not saying those who have been, Jonathan Edwards and others who have been like, you're like a spider dangling over the pits of hell. I'm not saying that those things don't have a place. Because I think there's portions of God's word that are very pointed towards us. But by and large, the vast majority of people, you've heard the, you'll win more flies with honey than vinegar. Our communication shouldn't be the thing that turns people off of the gospel. The gospel is a stumbling block in and of itself. Scripture says that. I'm not supposed to be the stumbling block. I'm supposed to do all that I can to get out of the way so that the gospel alone is the thing that causes someone to stumble. That I can't cause a person to turn away from the gospel. I can't cause a person to be offended by the way that I say it and turn away. You've probably heard the Ralph Waldo Emerson quote, your actions speak so loud that I cannot hear what you're saying. And if you have a relationship with somebody that's built on, I'm going to force feed you the gospel, it's not going anywhere good. The Lord tends to not use those things. He can use anything, of course, but our pattern should model the message of the Scripture. Our message is filled with joy, with hope, with love, with grace, with compassion, and we should deliver it with such. Our method should follow all of that. Ezekiel 18:23 says, this is the Lord speaking, he says, have I any pleasure in the death of the wicked, declares the Lord God, and not rather that he should turn from his wicked way and live? And verse 32 says, for I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the Lord God. So turn and live. Do you hear the compassion, gracious? Please, just listen. Jesus has died for you. to pay for your sins. Won't you trust him by faith? That's the message that Paul is saying. We ought to speak this way. And then he says, as we communicate clearly, we also need to live wisely. That's the third piece. Live wisely. He says, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. This idea, what he's saying toward, is it's a living relationship. It's like an ongoing thing. I'm being intentional. Not just I'm walking among them, but I'm walking towards them. I'm looking for ways that I can tell people about the gospel. We're to live in certain ways as believers, but we're to care for people and to step into those relationships. I don't think he has in his mind so much about like the comments like, oh, how come you're not having a beer? I don't think he means so much like that. I think he means more like, how in the world can you forgive someone who's hurt you so much? Like, those are the things that I have seen to be so much more significant in the lives of unbelievers when we have conversations like that. Each one of us, you should be looking for ways to build witnessing relationships. I didn't get his permission to say this, but I'm sure he would be okay with this. So Freddie was telling me, he was playing softball the other day and like invited all these guys who just happened to be at the softball field. Why don't you join our softball league, our church softball league? I love that. Just like, oh, I'm here. Let's build a relationship. I love that. We should go out of our way to find ways to care for people. A little while ago, you know, we recently moved, but before we did, we lived in a condo, and I was talking with my small group about ways that I wanted to grow in this. I work at a church. I mean, I don't like, you know, I interact with a lot of people, but all the people I work with are believers, and all of you are. That's great, you know. But I'm looking for ways that I can share the gospel more, that I can build these witnessing relationships. And there was this opportunity to like join the condo board, and the guys in my small group, I'm still mad at them for this. They told me you should definitely do that. I think that's probably an answer to your prayer. And I think they were right. I did get the opportunity to witness to all the other people on the board. It was, you know, I think the Lord used that. But I was looking for ways that wasn't the way I wanted, but thank you, small group. But all of that to say, look for opportunities. What's something you love to do? You love to play softball? You love to play basketball? Go to the YMCA and get a pickup game or whatever. You love to play golf? Join a golf league with some people. Whatever it is, use some opportunities that are already around you, some things that you love to do, and build witnessing relationship. Look for specific ways to build relationships with people. Paul is asking here. He's asking the Colossians to pray that he might have more evangelistic opportunities, more chances to share the gospel, more people to come in contact with, that he would be able to do that. And what he's saying here is it's to take full advantage of every opportunity that's in front of me, to make a good use of every chance I have, to take advantage of every single one of these chances. I mean, how often do we miss the opportunities that are all around us to tell people about Jesus Christ? There's a famous account of D.L. Moody on October 8th of 1871. And the service is coming to a close, and he had been preaching the gospel. But instead of calling people to receive Jesus Christ right there, he thought, you know what, I'll come back next week. I'm going to do it next week. So he shares the gospel, but he doesn't actually do a full gospel invitation, doesn't call the people to that. Does anybody remember what happened at 9 p.m. on October 8th of 1871? You weren't there either? Okay. That was the Great Chicago Fire. This building, the roof didn't, but the exterior of this building survived. But hundreds and hundreds of people in our city lost their lives that night. So much so that the organist was playing the close of the service, and it was drowned out by all of the fire bells around the city as Moody is coming to an end of his sermon. And so he was deeply moved by this because several hundred people lost their lives. And many of the people who were in the congregation that night didn't live to see another day. They died that night in the fire. And Moody made the proclamation, he made the decision, I'm not ever going to miss another opportunity to share the gospel. I'm not ever going to miss another opportunity to call people to trust Jesus Christ right now. I don't know if I will ever see him again. I don't know if her and I will ever be able to have a conversation about Jesus again. This might be my only chance, and I'm going to make every opportunity count? That's what Paul is telling us to do here. I'm grateful for, you'll hear more about it on Wednesday when we have the family forum, but I'm really grateful and excited about some of the ways the Closer campaign is happening and some of the resources that are going to be given just for our campus to care for the people in our city, the outreach of the gospel. And I'm telling you, we're spending a lot of time on a really in-depth plan to make every penny count for the gospel. Every penny is going out the door to share the gospel with Jesus Christ. And we're working really hard on a good plan for the next year or two or however long the Lord has us do this, but we're so excited about this opportunity. More is coming in terms of details, but we want to make every single opportunity count. I love that he partners here this idea of prayer for these opportunities, because I've noticed something. When I spend time praying for more opportunities to share the gospel, two things happen. One, surprise, that's a prayer that God answers. He wants more people to hear the word. So if you start praying, God, use me to tell more people about Jesus, he will answer that prayer. So that's one. Then I think the second thing that happens is God will open your eyes to many of the opportunities that you have to share Jesus Christ that you're missing. Many of the things that the people who are right around me that I didn't even think that I should share Christ with them, or I didn't even notice that opportunity, your eyes will be open to all of that. So when we partner prayer with witness, it's very powerful. And as we step into these opportunities, we're told to do so by speaking graciously. That's the next point, speaking graciously. He says, let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Our eagerness for our witness must not be the excuse for a brash or arrogance or being boring to people. We're to speak in a certain way. And I love that he says that it should be seasoned with salt. This idea that it brings flavor, it brings interest to the conversation. And Paul says that just like our salt is to a bland meal, our speech should be, the way in which we talk about the gospel with people will actually make the gospel more tasty and easier for a person to receive. Now, I'm not saying that we should be colorful in our speech in a way that diminishes the truth of God's word. Remember, clarity, simplicity, urgency. You don't have to get flowery about it. But what he's saying is there's a way of speaking graciously to one another that makes it easier for them to hear and to understand. The world has plenty of Christians who are all about condemnation. Plenty. That is all over. And most non-Christians, if you ask them what they think about Christians in general, that's like, they're hypocrites and they're condemning and those are some of the things that people say about us. But we have this perfect message of grace and forgiveness that's not what we deserve. So as we carry it to people, we should do so with grace in a way that makes it easier for them to accept it. That makes it easier for them. They may still say, the Christians are a bunch of hypocrites out there, but I know Michael, and Michael loves me. And yeah, he told me some things that I don't know that I really agree with those things, but man, that guy loves me. And I really appreciate the grace he's had with me. Like, that is what opens a door for the gospel. That is what seasons our speech with salt. Now, there are some specific things that we can do. I do think it's helpful in the simplicity and clarity piece to spend a little bit of time to be well-read. Go find a good book to read about the Christian faith. So whether it's Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis or Tim Keller has a great one called The Reason for God, or Lee Strobel has The Case for Everything, The Case for Faith, The Case for Christ, The Case for God, The Case for Creator, The Case whatever. So whatever it is, there's a ton of those. There's a lot of great websites. You go to YouTube and watch a couple Ravi Zacharias videos. I mean, the guy is just like, you know, like just these things that we do to stir up our faith are so helpful. Now, the reason why is because think of Philip in the Ethiopian eunuch. The dude's riding a chariot. He's reading a part of Isaiah, and he's like, I don't know what this means. How can I understand it if somebody doesn't tell me? And Philip is like, oh, no, I got that. I've read that part before. It says this, right in with the gospel. And then, look, there's water. What prevents me from getting baptized? Nothing. The guy gets baptized. And then, I mean, it's an amazing story. But none of that would have happened if Philip was like, I got to Google something first. Hold on a second. You know, like, he needed to be ready for that. And that's what Paul's telling us here. Be ready for those things. So it's helpful for all of us, if we really desire to share our faith, to do a little bit of work beforehand. Now, I find it very interesting to read some of these books, to listen to some of these sermons by Ravi Zacharias or others. There's so many out there that you could. And at the end of the day, there is no substitute for really knowing your Bible. For really knowing I don't know what Ravi Zacharias would say about it, but I know that passage in Ezekiel that talks about, you know, none, that the Father doesn't desire that any would perish. Or I know that passage. I may not be able to find it exactly, but I know there's the prodigal son story. Maybe that's a really good one. So just being able to think of things like that are really helpful, even if you can't think of the actual chapter and verse, but to have some of those things that you know about. So when you're talking with somebody. Now, if somebody asks you a difficult question that you don't know, I'm not saying you have to be like William Lane Craig, you know, uber smart or whatever with everything. Take some time to go find it out then. You know, Elvin, that's a really good question, and I don't know the answer to that. But I will, can I have your cell phone number? I will text you and we'll figure out another time. We'll sit together and I will find out. Now, here's a really important thing. Make sure you find out and go tell them afterwards. Because it's like the worst. If you're like, I don't know, that's a great question, bye. You know, like actually spend the time to go find it out. Here's what I've seen. I have yet to hear a question from someone who doesn't know Jesus Christ that there isn't a good answer to. Now, I don't always know the answer to it. I'm not that smart. But there's a good answer. There are people like Ravi Zacharias that are that smart. And there are good answers to every question. And so being willing to just say, I don't really know. That's an excellent question, but I'll find out. So spending the time to do that is really, really helpful in that way. I want to go through a list real quick. We can throw all these up on the screen too. These are important qualities in a gospel presentation. The things that we want to have so that we can communicate the gospel in a clear way. Some of these things we've talked about as well, but I find this list to be very helpful. Our communication of the gospel should be genuine. It shouldn't be like, well, I don't know, the pastor told me that I should go tell people about Jesus, so I'm going to go tell you now, I'm done, bye. You know, but like actually genuinely caring about a person. And I think the more we grasp the gospel for ourselves, the more we're driven to care about it for others. And then second, loving. Our communication should be done out of love, not out of I want to be right and I want to show you that I know more than you do. It's communicating that I love you and I want to communicate this in a way that is showing that. And then reasonable, just being reasonable as you communicate with people. Don't be crazy. Don't ask them for too much. Just communicate clearly in a reasonable way. Fourth, compelling. What we mean by this is not showing ambivalence to the gospel. I don't mean for a moment that you have to come up with a great sermon and 3 points and a poem and all of these sorts of things to like, I'm going to compel you to do it, to sort of strong arm somebody into it. But we shouldn't be talking about the most important thing like we don't care about. So showing the person that you actually do care about the message of the gospel and that it is of utmost importance, that it is urgent, and that will be compelling to people. Next, accurate, that I'm actually telling them the gospel. It is, you know, it is probably helpful to not, like, spout out heresy when you're telling somebody about the gospel, but it's okay because all of us, I promise you, I can't even count how many stupid things I've said in talking to somebody about the gospel. And later on, I might be like, oh, you know, that wasn't actually correct. I don't even know why I said that. It's not, because I've read this Bible verse, and this is actually more correct. It's fine. Just be accepting of that. I think it shows humility, and it shows grace as we seek for the accuracy of the gospel. Clear, speaking with clarity, as we already talked about. And then lastly, tailored or targeted. So different people hear the gospel in different ways. And, you know, Paul tells us this, this passage, 1 Corinthians 9, 19 through 23, is he says, you know, to all people, I became like all things. I sought for the different ways to understand people, taking the time, not to be manipulative, but like, I actually want to take the time to get to know you and understand you and tell you how this message can change your life. Our manner is to be modeled after the message that we're carrying. Our manner must be one of love and grace. speak this specific and clear and impactful truth. If we're to be wise in our witness, we must pray intentionally, communicate clearly, live wisely, and speak graciously. Now, I want you to, just in the moments that we have before we leave, I want you to take this little bookmark. You got one of these when you came in. On one side, it says wisdom as you witness. It has the passage. And on the other side, it's got a couple blanks here. Before you go today, so I'm going to give you a couple moments right now to just write the names of people who need to hear the gospel from you. Now, I'm grateful for our Closer campaign. I have names on that list, and I hope you do too. Some of these names can be the same. But I think we default too often to, like, I'm going to invite them to church. That's helpful. I do that too. But I think the thrust of this passage is far more, it's not about bringing them to church, it's going where they are. It's looking for those open doors that we have, and my job is to communicate clearly. My job is to carry the gospel to those people. And none of us who know Jesus Christ can say, well, I'm not an evangelist, I don't have that gift, or I don't, you know, somebody else is going to do it. But really to say, all of us have that job. Whether you feel gifted as an evangelist or not, all of us have the job and the responsibility to carry that message to people. And the people who are on your list, those people who you're writing down right now, you got a couple? Some of those people may not hear the gospel from anyone other than you ever. Some of those people, you are the only Christian that they know. You are the only one that has the tools to be able to communicate God's word with clarity to them. And so let this be a reminder, let this be a moment for us that we pray for an open door to the gospel. God, I'm not going to try to force this. I'm going to look for an open door to communicate your gospel. God, I pray that you would give me the grace to open my mouth and clearly speak the gospel. And God, lastly, I pray that you will give an open heart to this person, to these people on my list, that your Holy Spirit would do the work. Our job is to communicate with urgency, with clarity, with simplicity. The Holy Spirit will work in that. So we pray for him to do that. And let's pray now. Father, we are amazed, frankly blown away, that you would use broken vessels like us to carry such a perfect and flawless message, such an important message, such a precious message of Jesus Christ on the cross for us. God, we know that his sacrifice alone makes payment for sin. And every person in this world has a sin problem and needs a fix, but there is only one fix, and that fix is Jesus Christ. And God, we have this perfect message. We pray that you would give us open doors to share it. We pray that you would give us the clarity of speech, that we would step through the fear that we may feel to open our mouths to communicate the gospel to people. And God, ultimately, we pray for your Holy Spirit to work in these people's lives, to change hearts, to call men and women and children to trust Jesus Christ by faith. God, we see in our world and in our city each and every day a desperate need of a Savior. You alone have the words of eternal life, God, and you give them to us to steward them, to communicate them to your people all around the world. So we pray for your favor as we communicate them. We pray for your passion as we communicate with urgency all that you've done in our lives and all that you could do in theirs. God, would you save people? Would you cause a revival to happen in this city? Would you cause people to turn from their sins, to trust Jesus Christ, to be changed forever? God, would our city not be known for the violence, for the corruption, for all of the other things that it's known for, but would it be known as a lighthouse for Jesus Christ? Would it be known as a place where believers are flocking to your word? God, would it be known by a place that people are filled with grace and love and compassion to one another? I may not understand what they're saying. I may not agree with what they're talking about, but I know that they love one another, and I know that they've loved me. God, we pray that you would work. Thank you that you are that Father standing at the end of the rope with your arms open wide, accepting the prodigal children to return to you. God, would they return? Would the people in this city turn from their sins and run to Jesus Christ? God, we pray for your favor in our city. We pray for your work as only you can do. We give it all to you, Lord. Our lives are living sacrifices over to Jesus Christ so that you would use us for your glory and for the good of this city. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.